say, global conflicts we've always had. There's no question about it. Your Bible is, you take your Bible, and the Bible is full of examples. You know, it shows the varying empires, and the prophecies predict when those empires will succeed each other. They give a certain chronology. The Bible is absolutely fantastic and an accurate document when it comes to that. So there's a political motivation, there's an economical motivation, and there is a religious motivation claimed to be religiously induced as well. I would agree with the politically. Normally, politics is a terrible game. That the economics play a role, and that certainly is true in today's setup of the of our global entities. Religion is often misused. It just is used to justify. Do you know what I mean? And examples are some of the fundamentalist beliefs that do the rounds. You know each and every one of them there, don't you? Of course, this is Mrs. Macron. She's the only non-politician there, holding onto his hand there. You can see he's not looking very happy. If you watch a lot of television, you know when he's unhappy. Can I tell you he's very unhappy? Because Mr. Macron said that one of the detriments of world peace was nationalism. Which makes you think straight away of make America great again. He didn't quite put it like that, but he might as well have. He tweeted that same day that France had lost in the First World War and the Second World War, and if it wasn't for them, the Yanks, where would they be? Which is true, but you don't say it on a day like that. Terrible timing, but he did. Amazing what goes on. Of course, he represents the party that then was guilty and had to pay everything. And him, yeah, I don't know. His look always reminds me of the northern part of Siberia. He's got no soul. I look at that face, I see no soul. Just not amazing. Amazing. Okay. Causes of war. When we talk about World War I, this is what they figure. Have a look at this. This is a very brilliant little put together of the various parties, and it would take me half an hour to go through it and give you all the details, which I'm certainly not going to do. But you have two main camps. You've got the blue and you've got the red, haven't you? Now, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, of course, was then quite big at the time, at the end of the 19th century, connected with Italy, connected with Germany, and you can see the alliances and when the alliances were made. And they're very good, very clever. The Ottoman Empire would have been sort of today's Turkey, and it was reducing in power tremendously, but it was connected with Germany. Then you have, on the other hand, Russia, which was ruled by the Tsars, they were not communist, of course, that came much later. And so you had the Russians, the France, and Britain. Do you know, there's in the book of Daniel, the second chapter, there's a little statement that says that, and they will mingle with the seed of man. In other words, that the various member states would all intermarry. And if one thing is very true of the European history, let me tell you that the intermarriage in the north, in the European countries was absolutely incestuous. No doubt about it. Queen Victoria had about 40 cousins and nephews and uncles. All over, all royalty, all over Europe. The World War I had no reason to be there. World War I was really a family squabble of royalty. That's basically what it was when it comes down to it, really. Then, of course, we have Bulgaria and we have Serbia, and Serbia always wanted to be with Russia. The Bulgarians wanted to be on the other side because they were being held by the Austro-Hungarians. And it all started, of course, with the assassination in 1914, forgot the precise date, somewhere in June. Franz Ferdinand, the Archduke, supposed to be the successor of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. You remember, you know your history too. Okay. Now, they have traditionally cited for long-term causes of the First World War nationalism, and that was Mr. Macron said that so blatantly. And he was not, he's not popular anymore with Donald. Nationalism, a devotion of the interest of a culture of one's nation. Me first, you maybe second, but a very distant one. Imperialism, you know, colonialism was rife. If you look at the last century, the previous century, and the one before that, colonialism was rife. Economic political control over weaker nations. Militarism, if you start colonialism, if you start asserting yourself, you will have to spend more money on military, right? And if you're going to spend a lot more money on military, one day you might want to try it out. And we're heading that way again, in a sense. The alliance systems, well, yeah, that has never really helped, because if there's a dispute between two minor parties, because there are alliances, more countries come involved than there should be or need to be. And that's a tragedy, and that has only happened too often. I like this little clip, because this one really tells you that World War I, when you had the military and the civilian casualties, 17 million deaths, 20 million wounded. That is an awful lot of people of a population total that is only a fraction of what we have today, 100 years ago. But of course it culminated really, and it had to culminate in the inevitable Second World War. And it was horrendous what happened there, and the collateral damage, the people that got killed, maimed, and the people that participated in these conflicts. It was terrible when you really look at it. One man found his way. I have never quite, I tried to read his book, Mein Kampf, it's as boring as it comes, but he wrote that. I tried to understand the man. He had evolutionist thinking, of course. He wasn't, maybe a touch agnostic, but not a lot. How somebody can, in cold blood, have millions of people just exterminated because that's what you believe. And then function reasonably normal. Well, was it? Anyway, the people loved it. He knew how to manipulate the crowds. He knew. The military and civilian casualties, the military 25 million deaths, collateral ones, 18 million people. And if you add up some of the other conflicts of that century, last century, you arrive at a figure of 180 million killed because of war. It's a terrible thing, it's a terrible thing. Global wars, when you look at it now, the number one cause normally is cited as religious, but I question that. Because when we look at the wars of the last century, they were not religious. No. They were not.
They were political.
They were political threat. And economical.
Atheism.
And of course, God was on everybody's side. I always love that. It's like two football games, and you know, they go to the, I saw the ones, two South African games. Rugby league. So they go together and they all get together like this before they start the game. And what do? They're playing on Sunday then. And what do? They're all praying to God, and God gives them the victory. So God can only hear one prayer at a time then, isn't it? But one of them has to win, one has to lose, isn't it? It's ridiculous. Okay. Have a look at this. You know, this is not true. And there's another thing that is true. This is very true. Yes, there is, there certainly is terrorism, and they feed on extremism, and that Islamic one is the one that comes to mind, but it's certainly not the only one, by the way. What really is remarkable, that religion does not prevent wars. Are you with me? That is the one that gets me. It doesn't prevent it. And I've always pondered on as a youngster, why that last war, the Second World War, had to find place. How does it get past the masses that know the Bible, the church going, Judeo-Christian nations? I can't explain that. Let's go to the beginning. There's some answers at the beginning, the antediluvian world. This is before the flood. In Genesis 6, it says, the wickedness of man was great in the earth. It was what?
Great.
That every intent, I want you to see what it says. This is humanity, fallen humanity. That every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. How many intents?
Every.
Sometimes evil. Only evil. Continually. Absolutely. That's an amazing indictment. God let the antediluvian world go for as long as he could, and then he did what he had to do. And millions died. Millions. How many? Don't know. Bible is silent on that. Make no mistake, God will do this again. If there is nothing that God can do, if probation must end, it will end. And God will act. That happens to be a fact. And this is a very strong reminder. Only Noah. I know Mrs. Noah came into the ark, so did the three boys who weren't even born yet when he got the commission. There's three wives, sure. But I would say there was one righteous man that the Bible points out, and that was Noah. If God couldn't have waited another generation, mankind would have been so estranged from God, he would have never had a mention anymore. The earth was also corrupt before God. They had corrupted their perception of God, and the earth was filled, was absolutely filled with violence. And you know what? That is very true of today. We live in a violent world. Now, I can list you, I don't know how many things, I'm not going to do that. If you watch the news, you see the violence as it is perpetrated. The hatred as it is perpetrated. I'll come back on hate crimes in a minute. But this is what Jesus said, that as in the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. He will come. And he will come when we have these statement fulfilled that I just showed you, that mankind is evil constantly, continually, where the world is filled with violence, and we are really, 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 we are there. When you look at the post-diluvian world, it was really no better. You know what amazes me about the antediluvian world? They had so much. They had no need for violence. They had so much reason to be grateful, but they were ungrateful. The ecology was perfect. It was fantastic. The post-diluvian world was very different. But there you are. You still have one people. And one people, and they have one speech. They all speak the same language. And that is helpful for understanding communication, isn't it? You always wonder what language that might have been. It must be a language that is had a good intellectual property. I think it was Dutch myself. But if I'm wrong, the Bible doesn't say that. And so God's reaction to this is this. Come, let us go down, and they confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. Linguists tell me, they tell me that if you look at all the languages, there are some 3,000 there, if you bring them together, you can all really trace them back to a most common language. It's quite interesting. There are some good papers written on that. Anyway, the Tower of Babel. It never got finished. It never got finished. God stopped it. There are three enterprises undertaken by mankind that never finished. The Tower of Babel was the first. They never finished it. Does anybody know what the second one was? The Chinese Wall. The one built to keep the rabbits out. Yeah. It was never finished. And the third one, undertaken by mankind and never finished, of course, is the light rail here in Sydney. Come, let us go down, and they confuse their language that they may not understand one and another's speech. Now suddenly, they don't get on anymore. There is an enormous hostility. There is a separation, there is a tremendous distrust, and they leave in the scene. And this story that you will find in the early chapters of the book of Genesis is such a fantastic account. Let me tell you something. This man here, William F. Albright, if ever you do anthropology, this is the name you'll come across a great deal. This man is highly regarded, stands actually quite elevated above his peers. He said this on the account of Genesis. He says it stands absolutely alone in ancient history without a remote parallel, even amongst the Greeks, where we find the closest approach to a distribution of people in the genealogical framework. He says the table of the nations, referring here to the 11th chapter of Genesis, the table of the nations remained an astonishing, accurate document. You can trace all the nations back to that document that you hold in Genesis. That's amazing. Yet there's nothing like that in antiquity. You couldn't doubt the Bible for accuracy. So whatever else it tells us, it's been a very, very accurate. Go to Abram. Let's talk a bit about Abram. He had two sons, right? Who was first? Ishmael. It was a meme. The Lord will hear. Shema is hearing, Yishma. El is the singular for Elohim. So he had him about the age of 85, thereabouts. Now what is so fascinating of Ishmael? You know, people sometimes dismiss the Bible as an irrelevant document, but if you look at the history of this world and understand the absence of world peace, you should go to the Bible because it tells you so much. And so, he is the progenitor of all the Arabs. Hundreds of millions of Arabs around the world. Which is interesting that, you know, after Abraham, 2,500 years later, there is a philosophy, there is a religion that we call Islam. Starts with the Arabs, as we know. Not confined to, but that's where it starts. I want you to bear that in mind. Now the other son, who comes around about 14 or 15 years later, is Isaac. Isaac is the progenitor of the Jews, because the blessings, the birthright, everything went from Abraham to Isaac, as I will show you in a moment, as it is recorded in the Bible. Now we only have about, well, I don't know, 18, 19 million Jews around the world. Not that many. It's amazing that the descendancy of Ishmael is so much more dominant. But you know what is remarkable when I look at today's news and the history, particularly what I see happening around the Middle East, talks about the Arabs. And it says he, that is Ishmael, the progenitor of all the Arabs, he will be a wild man. In fact, the Bible says he shall be a wild ass of a man. That's a bit more colorful. His hand shall be against every man. He'll be very argumentative. And every man's hand against him. He's against other men. And he shall dwell in the presence of all his brethren. That's wonderful. But you know, it's true. When you look at the Middle East, the Middle Eastern policies and occurrences, this statement is really a prophecy that is coming about. They're fighting amongst each other, and I'll show you in a minute. See, the Jews escaped various religious persecutions, of course, from other countries, and of course the Holocaust. 1947, the United Nations divided Palestine. 1948, Israel declared a state. The Israeli War of Independence ensued, and there were a couple of them after. Now, this is interesting. So they Shemites, well, the Arabs are Shemites as well, because they're descendants from Shem as well. That's the interesting part. But the Jewish nation, there in 1947, the green part is occupied by the Arabs. And then you see the reduction as we go along. And I don't want to linger, but when you look at the present time, which is probably this, like the West Bank here, is just about disappearing because Israel is building settlements all over the place, totally ignoring the treaties and agreements that they haven't placed before.
Now, I lived in that territory for a few years, and I know that those Palestinians have a real good case. Because they were dislodged, you see. And they lived there for hundreds of years. Now, the problem is this. Both the Israelis, the Jews, and the Arabs claim the territory, a divine right to possess the land. And this is very fascinating when you go there. This is the Dome of the Rock. That is where Muhammad on horseback, of course, went back to heaven, according to Islamic beliefs. That's the Al-Aqsa Mosque, which is significant, that's really used. It's on a temple mount, we call that, and this is where you had the Solomonic Temple, right on that site. Now this is interesting, this came here in the early part of the 7th century AD, and then this one came somewhat later. But the interesting thing is the temple, the one that was destroyed in 70 AD, can be rebuilt according to the Bible, but it has to happen, it has to be built on this temple mount. And it's never going to happen. Because the whole argument is about this parcel of land. That is the third most holy site of Islam. There never will be a complete armistice between the Jews and the Arabs, between Judaism and Islam. When I was there, that was conquered. The Jordanians defended it, they defended it very well, but it was taken by the Israeli army. And they actually control now the old city and all the hassles that come with it because of their settlements. I think it's just interesting. Here we are. We're looking at the world. We may not be inclined to follow politics and world events as they happen, but you know, they are affecting you as you are sitting here. And what is so remarkable that you can turn to a Bible and open a Bible and see how relevant the Bible is. Its predictions are 100%. The information is so accurate and it gives you a fantastic background. The curses of disobedience as uttered by Moses in his farewell address, he said this, the Lord, and he made a prediction here, I want you to have a look at this, please follow this. The Lord will bring a nation against you from afar, and we're talking about the Romans here, as you will see, from the end of the earth, which is pretty well what it was to them, as swift as the eagle flies, they had the eagle on their shields, they had the eagle on their banners. A nation whose language you will not understand. They speak Latin. Of course, they didn't understand that. A nation of fierce countenance which does not respect the elderly nor show favor to the young. And they didn't. They shall besiege you at all your gates. They did until your high walls and fortified walls in which you trust come down throughout all your land. And they shall besiege you at all your gates throughout all your land which the Lord has given you. And that's exactly what happened. And that culminated in 70 AD when they took Jerusalem under Titus. It's amazing that some 1500 years, more than 1500 years before, he makes this prediction and he gave the description. Then the Lord will scatter you amongst all the people. Now, who is scattering them amongst all the people? The Lord. The Lord is. In other words, the warning is if you don't follow the Lord, this is what will happen to you. They didn't obey God, and that's exactly what happened to them. In 1948, the new state of Israel is not nullifying the fact that it is an unstable area, has absolutely no biblical fulfillment. They just congregated together again because they indeed had the sympathies of the Holocaust of the Second World War. From one end to the earth to the other. You see, there is no valid claim to the divine right to possess the land by the Jews. There is no lasting armistice for them. And there cannot be. Because of the people that have an interest in it. And I told you, so does Islam. The book of Daniel tops it off very nicely. In the 9th chapter, the unbelievable statement that says this. Gabriel is talking to Daniel, who In this year, 539-538 BC, offers a prayer, which is a magnificent prayer. And in that prayer, he's pleading for his people and for his city, Jerusalem. For decades, the temple, the Solomonic temple, has been destroyed and lays in ruin, as does the whole of Jerusalem. And so he's praying and praying and praying, pouring out his heart, and then Gabriel comes to him and he says, oh yes, you people, Daniel, they will return. They will return. Jerusalem and the temple will be rebuilt. That's exactly what happened. In 516 BC, they rededicated the rebuilt temple. They will be on probation for 490 years. It is amazing, the detail. The Messiah will come. Jerusalem and the temple will be destroyed again. And there's an outline of history which covers a few thousand years, and it's exactly what happened. It's exactly what happened. And you can't deny it was written when it claims it was written. You could prove that. The fact of the matter is, it is so accurate, it is stunningly accurate. And so you look at that, and you'd have to concede that the Bible would have to be such an inspired book. What does do the Jews do with this? They have the same Old Testament as you and I have. But here is the interesting thing. Whether it's evolution or creation, people believe what they want to believe, what suits them, every time. Every time. You can present all the evidence against it. I mean evidence. And they still will be unwilling to let go. And so here we have a curse of the Talmud. May the spirit of those who attempt to calculate the final time, that is the close of probation of the Jews, the one I just mentioned, the one that is in the book of Daniel, the one that they have in their Bible, the Tanakh, it is there. And so is the curse, and there you have the reference in the Talmud, it's there. So to put a curse on a writing that you know comes from God, is inspired, then becomes your answer to your problem? I don't think so. Is that right? Does that resonate here? Yeah, it doesn't. So it's fascinating. So back to Abraham. I love this one. The old smoothie. There was nobody like Bill Clinton. Never. No, he didn't. 1993, he tries to get the two together, Yitzhak Rabin and Yasser Arafat. Neither one of them are alive today. Bill Clinton still is. See, it's really about Isaac and Ishmael, and he was trying to bring them together. But they're much further apart than they ever were, because God is not in it. No armistice for them, the two sons of Abraham. Neither can claim the divine prerogative, the right to possess the land, because Abram gave all that he had to Isaac, but Abram gave gifts to the son of the concubines which Abram had. He had Keturah. He had another six sons after Isaac, but Abram gave gifts to the sons of the concubines which Abram had, and while he was still living, he sent them eastward away from Isaac his son to the country of the east. Isaac was going to inherit the land, ultimately. That is when they would come out of Egypt. But his other sons were sent away. And this was at the direction of God. They had no entitlement to the land. I'm just saying, we have a world politics that is so dominated by this reality. And so much has come from it. Many political agendas. And the Bible predicted this. Here is the reality. I love politics. Do you like news, politics? You know, you should take notice. Take time. Take time. And then go to your Bible. You'll be amazed what it teaches. It's about Sunni versus Shiite. It's not about Jews against Islam so much. It's not. Not really. It's really Sunni versus Shiite. When you look at that, the dark blue one are Shiites. And I won't go through this, but I want to draw your attention to this country here, where the most unbelievable suffering is finding place right now. Oh, it is heartbreaking. And the world sits by and does nothing. It is absolutely criminal. And when you look at the oil, which is where the money is, this is Yemen, you can see why Saudi Arabia wants to control that, because their ships have to go through there. It's all about money. So in other words, Sunni versus Shiite, yes, but don't forget, it is political, it is economically, and they use their religion to justify. Do you understand? And that formula works every time, everywhere, pretty well. Remember, he will be a wild man, an ass of a man, and his hand shall be against every man, and every man against him. That is true about that whole area there. You wouldn't want to know what goes on there. Hate crime. I hate crimes, but a hate crime is even worse. Doesn't matter who it is against, doesn't matter how much you disagree with someone. In fact, there was one that I just picked on this one because it just got such news. Remember this man? He had a newspaper there in Saudi Arabia. He's not a rebel, but he's a progressive man. He went against some of the opinions of the king, and that cost him his life. He died on the 2nd of October 2008 in Istanbul. Why? Because he walked into the embassy there thinking he was perfectly safe, and moments later he was died, and there was a squad ready to chop him up in all pieces. And nobody knows what they've done with the body, and you will never know. In today's days, today's time, just because you don't agree, this is inexcusable. What I find so objectionable is that the government that is really responsible for this, because don't tell me it is, they're not, they are, they don't mind. And we're dealing with them. It's absolutely incredible. Amnesty International, I've mentioned this a few times and I can't help this. She has been the greatest disappointment I have ever known. The Amnesty International is stripping away Myanmar's de facto leader Aung San Suu Kyi of its highest honors, which is the Ambassador of Conscience Award. Why? The deadly silence, what they did to the Rohingya, the Muslim majority, is obscene. It should not happen in our world. But it happens. And nobody lifts a finger. There is no amnesty, really. None whatsoever for these people. You know, the world's top five executioners are Iran, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, and Pakistan. Now they have Sharia law. I can understand that, but here is one that I find also very difficult. You won't get a number. Well, that's another story. I'm just saying that summary executions are just horrendously high in China, and we're dealing with them. A very major trading partner. And I have a clip here that I wanted to show you, and Randy, you're the one that... I might have shown this before, but there it is. It takes a few minutes.
Look at their faces, faces of loss, homes, villages, even countries lost. Their harrowing stories are of fear and flight and courage. In 2015, 3.2 million were seeking asylum, the highest number in history. There were 21.3 million refugees, the highest number since the 1990s. And 40.8 million were displaced in their own country, the highest number ever. A total of 65.3 million people. Forced displacement has doubled in less than 20 years, from 33.9 million to more than 60 million people forced from homes, driven to flee. This is their testimony.
أقل شيء هي أبوي راح لليوم ما نعرفه ما يطيب ما نعرفه
شو صار معه
راح بالأحمس
Increasingly, this affects each one of us. In 2015, one of every 113 people on the planet was either seeking asylum, internally displaced, or a refugee. Every minute, 24 people were newly displaced in the world. That's a population greater than all of France. Most were found in the Middle East and then Africa. Europe had the smallest number, and that included Ukraine and Turkey. One of every 113 in the world. That is a crisis.
Дедушка прошел Великую Отечественную войну. Разве он знал, что такое будет?
It is not Syria. It is not Syria. It is, I think, it is a kind of famine.
My mother was shot during that crisis, and my father has left us to come here and went back. We don't know why he's here.
Global displacement is higher than ever.
The main highlight is that we have an almost 10% increase of people on the move, refugees, displaced people, asylum seekers from last year. This is not good. And we should not forget, 90% of those people are not in the rich world. They are in developing countries, in middle income, poor countries, but it is the magnitude that strikes the most.
Most of the world's refugees come from three countries, Syria, Afghanistan, and Somalia. The highest number of internally displaced are in Colombia, Syria, and Iraq. In 2015, 51% of all refugees were children, and almost 100,000, 98,400 exactly, were alone, unaccompanied, or separated from their families. Those who flee bombs and terror find their suffering isn't over. Hundreds have died in dangerous sea crossings organized by illegal smugglers. And thousands more are blocked far from their goal, and many are simply pushed back.
Instead of developing better asylum systems that are hospitable, that recognize the hardship and the difficulties and the reasons for people to flee, barriers are erected. And the barriers need not be physical. Sometimes they are legislative barriers. We see this in Europe. We see the lowering of the threshold in the quality of asylum laws.
The numbers increase alarmingly. The numbers are people, individuals torn from peaceful lives, driven into danger and exile. Sympathy is not enough. Money is not enough. Action, bold action, is needed to deal with a crisis spanning the world.
Now, I trust that you found that clip very informative. This is a brief collection of what's happening around the globe. We don't know how lucky we are that we live where we live, isn't it? Incredible, really. And what have we done to deserve the privileged position that we have? Or maybe we should reason that one day we'll have to give an account of that privileged position. The annual Credit Suisse Global Wealth Databook commented on this, and it's recorded by Oxfam. The world's richest 1% owned more than the rest of the world combined in 2016. That's an obscene figure, but that's what they say. The World Bank, and working with the IMF, people are concerned about the conditions imposed upon the borrowing countries. Why? They fail to resolve the economic problems within the countries, and the poverty relief programs create further dependency. They set the interest rates, they set the duration, the calling of the loans. It is quite obscene what they get away with. Good economies is when you go to work and you spend. Bad economies, of course, is when you borrow and spend. And it was Solomon who made this observation, and the rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is servant of the lender. The perils of borrowing, and yet you look at our personal debts in countries like ours. In fact, the worst offender, of course, is the United States. It's heading towards 22 trillion. Even on a lower figure, the average household debt, before they buy anything, get anything,
would be already over $250,000. This is crazy stuff. I like this man, what he says. He belonged to the Church of Christ. He was a revivalist. David Lipscomb, very good, godly man. He said this: all the wars and strife between tribes, races, nations, from the beginning until now, have been the result of man's efforts to govern himself and the world. You get that? It's that simple. So we call it armistice. Yeah, what's the armistice? Let me, in conclusion, show you one particular thing which I thought was a great story. If only man could submit to the government of God, we would solve our problems. I like this one. Somewhere in Africa, I don't know the place, I read the story, there's a modern day missionary, he went to Africa, and he went to a church somewhere, and they had communion service. And he sat next to a very elderly man who told him the story of that church and the interaction that they had, these three tribes. And he began to tell him that, and I don't know how you pronounce it, Ngoni tribe, used to fight the Nasenga tribe and the Tumbuka tribe. What they used to do regularly, and he said, that's only a generation ago. He still had the photographs. In fact, he showed them one. He still had the photographs. They would go, these people would go to these people and murder and kill, leave the blood on the weapons, because that was their trophy, and they would take their women, of course, abuse them, take them with them. And this went on for generations after generation after generation. It was this day, the bloodshed was always there. Until one day a missionary comes in and he tells them about Christ, you see. And he tells them about the forgiveness and that God loves everyone. And that life is sacred. And that we are to love each other. And the man turned to the missionary, he said, you know, on this very table now, you have people from all three tribes. We are brothers in Christ. The secret to an armistice that lasts is the blood of Christ. It's the blood of Christ. And one day, we're going to live that. I can't wait for a world where I don't see suffering or don't have to suffer. Nothing to fear. Absolutely nothing to fear. Nothing to hate, nothing to dislike, no resentment. Just beautiful coexistence, true love, learning about God, learning about the universe. God has a wonderful, incredible, incredible future for us. We can leave all this behind. I'd like that. I really would like that. I hope it is your heart's desire to, and that one day we will live it. God bless you.
Thank you.
face here this afternoon, and we wanted to be closer to you on this your day that you have appointed in obedience we hear. And we just consider, we just contemplate the realities of the world that surrounds us, and sometimes when we look at things we may despair. I wonder where it all will be going one day, and what will be happening to the generation after us, if there will be one. And then we must realize that you are the one that is in control. Not us, not anybody else, you. It's just you. You are the God who is in control of this planet, this world. And we want to be under your control too. Lord, hold us, draw us, do what is ever needful in our life to let us allow you to take that full control over our lives. Not our will, not our reasoning. Your will, your word, your ways. So bless us, we pray. Lord, we also pray for the blessing on the food and refreshments. We're grateful for those who have brought it and prepared it, and that it may nourish our bodies. And Lord, that we may enjoy the fellowship, and that we be here again and come back to this place for worship. Worshipping you, worshipping, study your word, and knowing that you are the Almighty God and there are no other gods before you. Bless us now, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.